Indices are, of course, important in their own right, but they're also essential for being able to differentiate and integrate. What is crucial is that you realise that indices do not work in the same way as normal numbers. We all know that an index of 2 means squaring, not doubling, but as a result, an index of 1/2 doesn't mean halving, and an index of -2 doesn't mean multiplying by -2, or anything else to do with negative numbers. In this video, we shall look at the laws of indices, fractional and negative indices, and simplifying expressions ready for differentiation and integration. There are 3 main laws of indices from which all facts such as anything to the power 0 equals 1, a power of 1/2 means a square root, and an index of -1 is reciprocal can be deduced. Law 1 is for multiplying terms with indices. X to the a times x to the b is x to the a plus b. Law 2 is for dividing terms with indices. X to the a divided by x to the b equals x to the a minus b. And law 3 is for raising a term with an index to another power. So x to the a, all to the power of b, equals x to the a times b. You meet these rules at an early age, but they still give rise to some surprising results. Fractional indices. We know that when we multiply, say, 5 by itself, we get 5 squared, or 25, and that 5 is called the square root of 25. With indices, if we want to find the expression which gives us x to the 1 when it is multiplied by itself, i.e. the square root of x to the 1, we can use the first law of indices. What we want is to solve x to the n times x to the n equals x to the 1. The first law of indices tells us that n plus n equals 1, or 2n equals 1, and hence n equals 1/2. Therefore, the square root of x is x to the power of 1/2. We can extend this to cube roots and beyond. For example, if x to the n times x to the n times x to the n equals x to the 1, where x to the n is the cube root of x, we find that n is 1/3. That's fine for fractions with a numerator of 1. For fractions with other numerators, we can bring in the third law of indices. So let's say we have x to the power of 2/3. The third law of indices tells us that we can write x to the 2/3 equals x squared to the power of 1/3, or x to the 1/3 squared. Hence, if we have an index of 2/3, we must square and cube root in either order. This can be extended to any fractional index, a over b. We raise the term to the power of a, but also apply the b-th root. Note also that with a term such as x to the power of 3 over 2, we can also split it up using the first law. Hence, x to the power of 3 over 2 equals x to the 1 times x to the 1/2, which is x root x. Negative indices. The second law of indices can help us make sense of negative indices. If b is greater than a, then a minus b is a negative index. So to generate a negative index, we divide a lower power of x by a higher power. This will result in a fraction. For example, 4 cubed divided by 4 to the 5 equals 4 to the minus 2. But 4 cubed is 64, and 4 to the 5 is 1024. Dividing 64 by 1024 gives us a 16th, confirming that 4 to the minus 2 is a fraction. It is no coincidence that the denominator of 16 is 4 squared. In general, x to the power of minus a is 1 divided by x to the power of a, and k times x to the power of minus a is k divided by x to the power of a. People often get in a muddle over negative indices, particularly when fractional indices are involved. Remember, fractional indices are roots, negative indices are fractions. It is unfortunate that fractions are mentioned in both rules, but that just emphasizes the fact that you need to make sure you know and understand both rules. Here are 2 relationships that you must try not to get confused. 12 over x squared is 12x to the minus 2, whereas 12 over the square root of x is 12x to the minus 1/2. Fractional and negative indices. A case study. Consider 9 to the power of minus 3 over 2. Bearing in mind everything that has been stated before, we need to do 3 things to turn the 9 into the value represented by 9 to the power of minus 3 over 2. We need to reciprocate, we need to cube, and we need to square root. It doesn't actually matter which order we do them in, the answer will be the same. However, it is often the case, as it is for 9 to the power of minus 3 over 2, that it is easier to do it in a particular order. Here, for example, it is easier to square root before cubing. The square root of 9 is 3, 3 cubed is 27, the reciprocal of 27 is 1/27. So, 9 to the power of minus 3 over 2 is 1/27. Common misconceptions. The four expressions on the right all contain a 16 and an index of minus a half. It wouldn't be difficult to muddle them up. It is important to know that an index only applies to the number or letter it is directly attached to. Having said that, if an expression is in brackets, the index will apply to everything in the brackets. Make sure you understand the answers for all four. Simplifying expressions ready for differentiation and integration. To differentiate or integrate a term in a polynomial, you need to write it in index notation before you start. It is quite common in a calculus question to be given a fraction with more than one term on the numerator to cancel with a term on the denominator. Here is an example of how to deal with that. We have 6 plus x cubed all over the square root of x. The square root of x is, of course, x to the power of a half. We can then split the fraction up into separate fractions, each with a denominator of x to the half. 6 over x to the power of a half is 6 times x to the power of minus a half. To divide x cubed by x to the half, we subtract the indices and get x to the power of 2.5. If you need help remembering what any of the indices represent, links to the songs Indices Song and Son of Indices are given below. Bye!